Jesus, the Lamb that was sacrificed. You came to earth in your humanity to show us the Father's face.
Welcome to our online service. Let's begin by praying together the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets." My dear brothers and sisters, the scriptures teach us to acknowledge our many sins and offenses, not concealing them from our Heavenly Father, but confessing them with humble and obedient hearts, that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy. We ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before Almighty God, but especially when we come together in His presence to give thanks for the great benefits we have received at His hands, to declare His most worthy praise, to hear His holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things which are necessary for our life and our salvation. Therefore, draw near with me to the throne of heavenly grace. And praying together, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them with true repentance and true faith, turn to him. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And let's say together, affirming our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's listen to the Word of God.
The reading is taken from Mark chapter 1, verses 14 to 20. Later on, after John was arrested, Jesus went into Galilee, where he preached God's good news. The time promised by God has come at last, he announced. The kingdom of God is near. Repent of your sins and believe the good news. One day, as Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew throwing a net into the water, for they fished for a living. Jesus called out to them, "Come, follow me, and I will show you how to fish for people." And they left their nets at once and followed him. A little farther up the shore, Jesus saw Zebedee's sons, James and John, in a boat repairing their nets. He called them at once, and they also followed him, leaving their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I remember preaching my first sermon. It was about 40 years ago. It was not a pretty sight. I'm sure it was quite cringe-worthy. You see, public speaking was never one of my strengths in high school, or in fact college when I was studying forestry. I absolutely hated speaking in public. However, I did feel called to ministry, and preaching, of course, was part of the deal. And I remember agonizing in preparation for that first sermon. I looked at the text from the Bible, I made notes, I checked my small library for ideas, I started writing. That wasn't right, I tore them all up and started all over again. Hours of sweating over the sermon, days of it. And finally, it was done. Then, I had to preach it. Total fear gripped me. And I remember standing in front of the good people at St. John the Baptist Church in Pointe Claire, Quebec, glad that I was wearing long robes because they couldn't see my knees that were literally shaking. And somehow I got through the sermon without anyone walking out of the church. And after, I remember sitting down exhausted. I was just glad that it was over. I suppose it wasn't that hideous because the rector asked me to preach another sermon. You mean I have to go through that all over again? On occasion, I have nightmares about that experience in the pulpit. You know, standing there without my notes. Bad dreams where I'm standing at the front of the church with my long liturgical robes on, wearing hiking boots instead of, you know, Sunday black shoes. Or the proverbial wearing just underwear underneath the robes, not having any clue what I'm going to preach about. I'm sure there's some kind of psychological field day in all of this. But there is a point to this little story. You see, there is another preacher who I am sure had a totally different experience in his first sermon. So let's pray, and then we're going to take a look at the Bible. And this prayer today is taken from actually the collect of the day, which I think is really appropriate to the passage. Let's pray. Give us grace, O Lord, to answer readily the call of our Savior Jesus Christ and proclaim to all people the good news of his salvation, that we and the whole world may perceive the glory of us, of his marvelous kingdom, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Mark chapter 1, verses 14 to 20. One thing I've noticed about the four different Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, is the way that the Gospel according to St. Mark seems to be written in a style that is straight and to the point. Mark is the shortest of the Gospels. It moves along quickly. As we look at Mark chapter 1, verses 14 to 20, I believe it can be divided into two parts. First, in verses 14 and 15, we hear the good news of the gospel. And second, in verses 16 to 20, the response. First, the good news of the gospel, verses 14 and 15. Jesus went into Galilee where he preached God's good news. The time promised by God has come at last, he announced. The kingdom of God is near. Repent of your sins and believe the good news. Meaning the time is fulfilled. God's people had been waiting a long time for this. The words of promise, the prophetic words in the Old Testament promising that God would act in power, had finally come with the coming of Jesus Christ. With the birth and coming of Jesus, we see a special divine moment. The coming of the kingdom of God is the good news. And again, remember that God's people at that time were under pressure. They were under an oppressive Roman regime. They were an occupied people. In fact, for centuries, the people had prayed and prayed that God would deliver them. And as I mentioned, many Old Testament passages had promised that God was going to do something about the evil. And he did. We just celebrated at Christmas the sending of the one who was going to do it, Jesus. Jesus bursts onto the scene saying, "That's enough. It's here. God is on the move." Jesus himself will bring the kingdom in his teaching, his healings, and ultimately through his death on the cross. A new kingdom, a new king. It is amazing good news. Ever wonder what it was like to listen to Jesus preach? Now, we know from the Bible that he taught with authority. His preaching sure bothered some people, especially the religious leaders of his day. And of course, many people just loved it. They were drawn to listen to Jesus preach. If we were to analyze Jesus' first sermon, albeit on paper, quite short here, we can say three things about his first sermon. One, Jesus spoke about the kingdom of God. Two, he mentions belief. And three, he speaks about repentance. First of all, the focus of Jesus' preaching was the kingdom of God. When you hear the phrase, the kingdom of God, it's important not to think of a heavenly place, but rather a kingly rule, sovereignty, or a kingly reign. God, the king, is ruling. And that's a good thought. No matter what we see, God is reigning. He is the king. 2,000 years later, we know that in Jesus, the long-time promises and hope of God's people had come at last. In Jesus is the time of fulfillment and the reign of God coming in power. So, when you hear Jesus preach and when you see him heal the sick, cast out evil, raise the dead, feed the poor, you are seeing Almighty God's sovereign rule breaking into the world. It's good news. God is on the move in Jesus and continues to this day through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, often people get confused about the content of Jesus' preaching. They think that Jesus spoke mostly about love and forgiveness and, you know, being nice to people. Well, of course he did. But his main theme was the kingdom of God. Jesus' preaching was not even focused on going to heaven after you die. What, you say? The major subject of Jesus' preaching was not about going to heaven at death. Imagine that. His focus in his teaching was not so much that you will, you know, go off somewhere into some ethereal spiritual place and some kind of spiritual existence floating on the clouds in heaven when you die, but instead you will be resurrected in the future and that heaven is coming to earth, the new creation. Of course, Jesus said things like, "For God loved the world, that whoever believes in me should not perish, but have eternal life." But the heart and the core of his teaching was the kingdom of God. And the good news, the gospel, is that the kingdom of God would be established right here on earth through Jesus. And this theme was so important that even after Jesus had died and risen from the dead and appeared to his disciples 40 days later, during those 40 days, Acts chapter 1 tells us that Jesus saw them during those 40 days and spoke to them of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. He gives them a last instruction. This is all about the kingdom of God. Jesus wanted to stress to his followers that the kingdom is coming to this earth. He was assuring them that God's plan was right on track. Now, how was that going to happen once Jesus was gone? Through those who believed in him. Through the early church. Through the church throughout all of history, and even through Pastor Paul's second-rate sermons. God is on the move right now through you and me as we continue to be faithful to Jesus and pray and serve people and call people to know more about Jesus and to act in a way that reflects God's reign and his rule. And so that brings us to the second point and the second section of Jesus' sermon. Jesus called people to believe. Belief. What exactly is it? It's easy to say we believe by making a few, you know, cultural adjustments in our life. We can even say, I believe in Jesus. I go to church. I am a believer. But I can also say that I'm also a believer in good health and exercise. But it's a whole different thing to get out there and go for a walk and exercise. That is why Jesus spoke about repentance as well. Gospel preaching and gospel belief always involves repentance. And one of the best explanations I've heard about the meaning of repentance is this: a change of mind that leads to a change of direction in life. Belief and repentance are intimately linked. The greatest preacher of all time, the Lord Jesus, called people to believe in the kingdom of God and to repent. And so the preaching of the good news should compel us to respond. If you really listen to the gospel, you are faced with the choice of becoming his disciple or not. You really cannot separate them either. You cannot have one, as it were, without the other. Believing in the gospel involves discipleship. I heard someone say that the reason why there's so few, you know, true disciples in many mainline churches is because there has been so little preaching of the gospel. You have to have the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ being preached and taught. Take a look at verse 17. Jesus called out to them, "Come, follow me, and I will show you how to fish for people." When we study the Greek language that the New Testament was originally written in, we find this interesting fact that when Jesus says, "Come follow me," he is not saying it as a, you know, casual suggestion. "Hey guys, are you bored with your life? Tired of fishing? Are you nauseated by the smell of fish day in and day out? Feel like a change? Are you going through a midlife crisis and want some excitement in your life?" No. Jesus is saying, "Come follow me," like a curt military command. Attention, follow me. Sometimes we read Jesus' words here, "Come follow me," as sounding, you know, almost lame. But the sense in this verse is absolute urgency, a direct command that should be obeyed. Here's something else. In the first century, if you wanted to learn about God, you would take it upon yourself to search out a good teacher or a rabbi and say something like, "I want to learn from you, Rabbi so-and-so." But Jesus does a complete reversal. He approaches Simon and Andrew and later on James and John and asks them instead, "Come and follow me." And I have to, you know, this is to me another example of grace. God taking the initiative, God stepping in, God seeking and wooing and calling to his people. It's all about the love of God. It's all about grace. Think also of it like this. If someone came up to us and said, "Follow me," we would say, "Who do you think you are?" Unless we understand the strangeness and the challenge of Jesus' command here, we will not understand the passage. This is weird stuff. The point is the absolute nature of Jesus, who has all of the authority in the universe to call you and me, to command me and you to follow. If he was anyone else, we might say, who do you think you are? But because of who he is, the Savior of the world, the one who died for our sins, he has every right to ask us. And of course, you know that the word we use for following him is called discipleship. He is our rabbi, our teacher, our Lord, our God. And, to put it in a kind of a strange way, we are Jesus' groupies. And the reason why I say that, because I was reminded the other day, I'm taking an online course on worship, and so I had to introduce myself to the rest of the class. And I just started to think back, and I told them that I had come to a renewed faith at the tail end of the Jesus People movement in the 1970s. And the Jesus People movement began, I think it was around 1967, with the entrance of a number of Christian missionaries who took it upon themselves to share the gospel with all of all people to the hippies in Southern California. And though some people have minimized its impact, at its peak, the Jesus People movement generated over 800 communal houses that were focused on the Lord Jesus in the United States and in Canada. And it spawned a massive number of conversions to the Christian faith. And it reverberated throughout many countries in the world. Now, there's a lot of, you know, it's hard to measure these things, and there's estimates that it was about 30,000 people to 3 million people who were affected by the Jesus People movement. And I think we can safely say that the Jesus People movement, in some ways, has been almost a neglected part in the chapter of North American Protestant revival history. And I have to tell you that my friends who followed Jesus at that time, all of them went on not only to believe, but also to become pastors as well. Many of them I am still in contact to this day, 40 years or so later. Wouldn't you say it would be a good idea to pray for another Jesus People movement? I think so. But I digress here a little bit. Let's get back to the passage. Sometimes when we read the Bible, we think, well, it was easier for the first disciples because, after all, it was Jesus talking to them, and they saw all of the amazing miracles. We might think that some kind of, you know, hysteria gripped them because they saw the supernatural. But Jesus would often correct them and remind the disciples that following him meant counting the cost. And I think it's safe to say that you're not in hysteria today watching this online service. But the call is the same. If Jesus were here today, what would he say to the church? What would he say to Toronto? What would he say to our culture, to our leaders, to Pastor Paul, or to you? What would Jesus say? In verses 16 to 20, Jesus comes upon a few fishermen who are along the shore of Galilee as they're working. And I'm sure they must have heard about Jesus, maybe even heard him preach. It's not a really big place. Follow me. What does it mean to follow him? What did it mean for these fishermen? I think we can describe it as this. It meant for them an expanded life. It meant that their life of fishing, their community, their worship in the synagogue, or maybe even their trips to the holy city of Jerusalem were expanded. Life got a whole lot bigger. And we know the testimony from the rest of the New Testament that shows exactly that happening, even for them to go out to many parts of the world. Their life expanded. The Bible, of course, tells us that their life was never the same. And I guess the questions we can ask ourselves is this: is our life expanding? Are we being stretched in our faith? Are we even moving outside of our comfort zone? I know that my life can be contained instead of being expanded, meaning it could be so self-focused. Jesus wants to, as it were, explode all of that. It sure happened with the first disciples. The text tells us that the disciples left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed after Jesus. This is what happens when someone comes to Jesus. There's an element of some kind of leaving behind some stuff, maybe some attitudes, some selfish, self-focused practices. They all have to go. But at the same time, we have to see that the Lord here is committed to those disciples. Jesus is going to help them. He tells them, I'm going to help you become fishers of men. In other words, you're not going to do this on your own. You're not going to do this following me on your own. I am going to be with you. I'm never going to leave you. And there's many passages that tell us that. We will not be left all on our own. He will send us a helper, a comforter, the Holy Spirit. We need to understand and expand our thinking on the kingdom of God. We need to understand what belief really is, and we need to repent, of course, and follow. Now, I know that I am preaching to the converted. I'm just reminding you, but on the off chance that there might be someone watching today where this all might be a little bit new, I want to say the best part is that you can get a head start on the kingdom right now. Jesus can personally be your king right now. You can have a place in his forever kingdom right now. Jesus said, but seek first the kingdom of God, and all of these things should be added to you. Everyone needs to seek God's kingdom now. It should be everyone's primary goal, the central focus of our lives. God's wonderful kingdom holds all of the solutions to your personal challenges, and for that matter, for all of humanity's problems and dilemmas. No wonder Jesus constantly preached this. His first sermon, the time promised by God has come at last. The kingdom of God is near. Repent of your sins and believe the good news. Shall we? Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the good news of the gospel, for the kingdom of God, for the call to belief and repentance. And even now, Lord, I invite the power of the Holy Spirit to stir our hearts, Lord, to hear the command of the Lord Jesus to be his disciples. And Father, again, I pray for that person who knows the Lord is tugging at their heart today, who knows that he is with them, urging them, calling them to a deeper relationship with the God of the universe. And so I invite the power of the Holy Spirit to lead that person to the Lord Jesus himself, to the cross of Christ, to see the Lord Jesus forgiving their sins, putting them back on their feet, loving them, and promising them a place in his new creation. And I pray all of this Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Bless you. We continue in prayer. Let us with confidence present our prayers and supplications to the throne of grace. We pray for all those in positions of power, that they may govern with wisdom and integrity, serving the needs of their people. And Father, at this day, we continue to pray for our brothers and sisters in the United States, especially during this time of transition. We pray for your peace, your wisdom to reign. We pray for our own country, for our prime minister, for the premiers of all the provinces, and especially during these COVID days, we pray for true wisdom and guidance. May your reign come, Lord. Hear our prayer. We pray for the church, the sign of your reign, that it may extend your welcome to people of every race and background. Today we pray for the Anglican Network in Canada, for Bishop Charlie, for Judy, for all those in authority and leadership in our church. We pray for Archbishop Foley Beach and for the Anglican Church of North America. We bless you, Lord, for godly leadership. And we pray, Father, that it would continue to be led by the power of the Holy Spirit as we faithfully seek to preach and to proclaim the kingdom of God in the Lord Jesus. May your kingdom come. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the world and for those in our community. We continue to pray for the areas of our world that are in trouble, those places that suffer from poverty, from injustice. We ask the Lord Jesus to intervene. May the church intervene with prayer, with practical help. We thank you, Lord, for the ministries in our own community that take care of the needs of others. May we be faithful in proclaiming the truth and in helping those who are in need. May your kingdom come, Lord. Hear our prayer. We pray for each other, for our families, our friends, and we particularly intercede for those who are hurting at this time, who are suffering in any way, for those who are sick, for those who are depressed, who feel overwhelmed, for those who are fearful. We ask for the hand of the Lord Jesus Christ to be stretched forth, even now, right now, into the people that we are praying for. And so in our hearts, we name before the Lord those precious friends and family. Let's bring those people to mind right now. We ask for the encouragement of the Lord, the strength of the Lord, the healing of God to come on those whom we pray right now. May your kingdom come. Lord, hear our prayer. And we gather our prayers, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And together we pray. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all of your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen.
The world is in
and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Well, God bless you for joining us today. We pray that you would have a great week.